Hi friends, welcome back to my channel Only Bio. Presenting up the series of the challenging MCQs from Group A 71 to 75, all useful for NEET and all such competitive exams with detailed explanation. The first question relates with the chapter genes and the question is, according to current ideas concerning protein synthesis, and the options are A. Messenger RNA synthesized on a DNA template in the nucleus provides information that determines the sequence in which amino acids will be linked during translation. B. Enzymes that catalyze protein synthesizing reactions in the cytoplasm are transcribed from activated genes. C. Amino acids line up with their mRNA codons on the ribosomes and are then linked together by transfer RNA, and the transfer RNA molecules specific for particular amino acids are synthesized along a messenger RNA template in the cytoplasm. And the correct answer for this question is C. That is, amino acids line up with their mRNA codons on the ribosomes and are then linked together by transfer RNA. Let us understand this. See, protein synthesis can be divided broadly into two phases, that is transcription and translation. You may remember the central dogma of protein synthesis, right? So try to recollect that and you will understand this better. Now, during transcription, what happens is a section of DNA which has information for coding for a protein, which in simple words we call it as gene, it is converted into a template molecule, and this template molecule is called as mRNA. For this, it uses the enzyme RNA polymerase, and ye jo bhi process hai, this occurs in the nucleus. You can look on the screen, this is the DNA, and jab transcription hota hai, transcription is nothing but formation of mRNA. So this is how the mRNA is ought to be synthesized, with the help of RNA polymerase in the nucleus of the cell. Now, in the eukaryotes, mRNA is initially produced in a premature form, that is, we call it as pre-mRNA, from which then undergoes post-transcriptional modifications. So, in modifications ke baad jo banta hai, that is a mature mRNA. The mature mRNA, that is, you can look in the screen here, it is then transported from the nucleus via the nuclear pores. Okay, it is transported via the nuclear pores. Yani nuclear pores se ye bahar aa jata hai. Okay, and it is read by the ribosomes. So, it is going to be now present in the cytoplasm. So, what happens is mRNA will be read by the ribosomes. They will use the nucleotide sequence of the mRNA to determine the sequence of the amino acids. So, the ribosomes catalyze the formation of the covalent peptide bonds between the amino acids that have been brought, and this ultimately forms a polypeptide chain. Here you can see, and this process is called as translation. And after translation, the polypeptide chain folds to form a functional protein. So you can see amino acid being brought by tRNA, so it forms a complex amino acylation, jise aap kehte ho. And so protein synthesis, in simple words, it occurs in two steps. I hope you understood this. The next question relates with the chapter classification of animals, and the question is, largest nematocytes of cnidarians are important for dash. And your options are A. Testing the water quality, B. Survival, C. Feeding, D. Both B and C. And the correct answer for this question is both B and C. Look on the screen, please. Cnidarians are simplest organisms with tissue grade of organization. Now, you might be remembering, it is a next level after cellular organization. That means inmay cells come together to form tissues, and their bodies are made up of two layers of cells. of which the outer layer is called as the epidermis, and the inner layer, you can look on the screen here, the outer layer, that is epidermis, and this is the inner layer, that is called as gastrodermis. Now, in between these two layers, there is a sticky kind of a structure which is called as a mesoglia. So, it helps in sticking. It's a jelly-like substance, you can say. It consists of scattered cells and the collagen fibers, and it helps in connecting both the layers, that is the epidermis with the gastrodermis. This is the reason why we call them as diploblastic organisms. Now, what happens is, this particular epidermis, that is the outer layer, it consists of the nidocytes. Nidocytes contain nematocysts, and you can see this picture here. I have many more to show you. So, here it is. This is again a good idea. This is a cnidarian with the tentacles. Now, in cnidarians, the mouth is mostly surrounded by a ring of tentacles. And these tentacles are armed with, again look here, I have taken the pointer. This is the tentacle. So, these tentacles are armed with nidocytes. You can see here, right? These, in simple words, in our textbooks, we call them as the stinging cells. And the nidocytes, they contain the nematocyst with poison, which are unique because they help in defense and offense, capture of the prey. And because these are carnivorous, see, many a times aap logon ko confusion kahan hota hai, toh what is the difference between the nidocyte, the neuroblast, the nematocyst and the nematocyte. So, this is the reason why I just focus on the screen here. So, the cell is the nidocyte and it consists of an organelle, that is the nematocyst, and which is nothing but it's a function, it has a function as a weapon for injuring the prey and so on. Offense and defense. Okay, I'll take you to another. Here it is. This particular diagram is even seen in the textbooks. And in one of the competitive exams, only the diagram B was being given and the students were asked to identify it. So, it was very difficult for the students because there was no reference as such, because the labeling obviously was not there. And this is the reason why I have taken this black and white diagram. I will take you to the next, a better diagram for you to understand. Here it is. So, you can see this is a part of the tentacle. On the left hand side, this is a part of the tentacle. These are the cells, that is the nidocytes, and it has a barb like a small extension called as the nidocil. Okay, nidocil. I repeat, please remember, because nidocil will sense the movement and it will act like a trigger. So, this once it is going to act like a trigger, you can look here. This is the thread-like structure. This is the nidocil, which is sensitive portion, as I said, a hair-like thing. And this is a closed one. So, as soon as it is going to be sensitized, what happens is this entire structure pops out. Here you can see the barb along with the thread. So, we call it as the discharge structure, yeah, nematocyst after firing. Okay, now many of the times, the textbooks fail to mention that there are three types of nematocysts. First one are called as the penetrants, which just penetrate and inject the poison. Second one are those which are called as the volvent, which entangle the prey. And third, which secrete an adhesive substance called as the glutenin. Now, let us come to another point, that is, what is the difference between nidocyte and nematocyst? A very, very important point. Nidocytes are the specialized cells containing nidocyst, whereas nematocyst is an organelle inside the nidocyte. Jaise cell mein nucleus hota hai, waise nidocyte ke andar nematocyst hota hai. And this nematocyst is made up of an ejectable thread. Right now you have seen it on the screen, right? And that causes the sting. So, nidocyte is an ectodermal cell in the cnidarians, whereas the nematocyst is an organelle. Okay, sometimes the nidocytes can also be called as the nidoblasts or nematocytes. I repeat, nidocytes can also be called as nidoblasts or nematocytes. And the nematocysts can also be called as nidocysts or only nida. I hope you remember the examples of the cnidarians, corals, sea anemones, jellyfish, hydra, and so on. I now take you to the next question that relates with the chapter reproduction in animals. And the question is, Cowper's glands produce a transparent viscous fluid during sexual excitement which protects the sperms against dash. And your options are A. Acids, B. Alkalis, C. Active movement, and D. Water content. And the correct answer for this question is acids. Look on the screen here. This is a side view of the male reproductive system, and here you can see that this is the prostate gland. I'll take a pointer once again. So this is the prostate gland, and below this there are small projections seen which are called as the Cowper's glands, and this area is nothing but the urethra. Okay, this is the urinary bladder, so this is the urethra, which is a common passage for both urine and sperms in case of males. That is the reason why it is called as a urinogenital duct. Now, Cowper's glands, which you might be aware, are also known as bulbourethral glands. As I said right now, these are two small glands below the prostate gland, and they secrete a mucus-like fluid that serves as a lubricant for intercourse and an alkaline fluid to decrease the acidity of the urine residue in the urethra. It is also believed that the fluid helps with the motility of the sperms, and also it protects the sperms, or else because if the urethra is quite acidic, the sperms can be killed there. And it also lubricates the tip of the penis, which is called as the glans penis. The question relates with the chapter chromosomal basis of inheritance, and the question is regarding Klinefelter syndrome, which one of the statement is correct? And the options given are A. They possess female appearance but contain bare body. B. They possess female body but have no bare body. C. They possess male appearance but have a bare body. And D. They have male appearance and therefore have no bare body. Now the correct answer for this question is C. They possess male appearance but have a bare body. Friends, you might be knowing here, look on the screen. Here you can see the karyotyping done for a Klinefelter syndrome. You can see that it is a genetic condition which results when a boy is born with an extra copy of the X chromosome. In other words, they have XXY as their genetic composition. Now, but obviously, XXY here, the number of bare bodies is going to be just 1. Now, this condition isn't inherited, but it occurs as a result of random genetic error after conception. It is a genetic condition that affects the males, and most of the times it isn't diagnosed until adulthood. So it may adversely affect many of the organs, especially the testicular growth, resulting in smaller than normal testicles, which can lead to lower production of testosterone. The syndrome may also cause reduced muscle mass, reduced body hair, facial hair, enlarged breast tissue, that is called as a gynecomastia. Okay. And the symptoms may differ from one person to another. But on an average, gynecomastia, smaller penis, smaller testicles, taller than average height, longer legs, shorter torso, broader hips, kind of a feminine body structure, the tendency to be shy, weak bones, low energy levels are the symptoms you can see here. You can see a picture of that of a patient suffering from Klinefelter syndrome. And do not forget, they are most commonly also called as the feminized males. I take you to the next question. The last question is an additional question which can be related with microbes in human welfare. And the question is, axenic culture is dash A. Culture of tissue, B. Culture of gene, C. Pure culture without any contamination, and D. Pure culture of a microbe without any nutrient. And the correct answer for this question is C, pure culture without any contamination. So in other words, you can say it is germ-free, uncontaminated. So it consists of a single species or variety or strain of organisms. There is absolute no contamination, no other bacterium growing along with it. Actinic culture was first developed by scientist Diamond in 1961. And the other types of culture that are used are xenic culture, polyxenic culture and monoxenic culture. Friends, if you have liked, please hit the like button. Subscribe if you haven't and hit the bell icon if you haven't. Thank you so much.